Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to your Father's house. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, thank you for the sounds of Christmas, the sights of Christmas, the smells of Christmas. Thank you for all the things that make this time of year so important to us as we celebrate the coming of your Son into this world to be our Savior. We ask God that the music that we hear and the songs we sing would be pleasing to you. We ask that the prayers that we pray, that the scripture that we read and the message we hear, that the fellowship that we share, all of those things would be pleasing to you and would be the way that we're drawn closer to your presence and to one another, those who are in person and those who are watching us online. In the name of Jesus, amen. Take that little yellow card out of the pew rack, please, and fill it out. We have our last Wednesday night dinner for December this Wednesday. Fried chicken and sides, and add to the sides homemade macaroni and cheese. Now that's good comfort food when you've got fried chicken and mac and cheese. So please join us Wednesday. And then Thursday, men, please come to the men's supper. Perhaps you haven't been before or it's been a while since you've come. I hope you'll come this Thursday night. Sign up. The first time you come is free, but we need to know if you're coming. And we'll have barbecue and all those good sides. It'll be a great time of fellowship and food and a devotion. And then this Saturday, the youth are coming to our house for their Christmas party. Renee and I love hosting them, and we'll have a good time. We'll be there at 6 o'clock, and we look forward to hosting them. Two other things, if you look on the back of the bulletin. If you'd like to order a poinsettia, there are forms out in the lobby, and I think probably on this little table, for you to put a poinsettia in the sanctuary in memory or in honor of someone. And then why do we have baby bottles on stands around the church, right over here and out here and over here? What's that about? We want you to take one of those baby bottles home and fill it up with change or put a check or dollar bills, whatever you want to put in there. It's a way that we raise money for life choices to help young mothers and to help their children. We've done this for many years, and for several years running, get this, Highland Heights has been the church that has raised the most. We're raising more than much larger churches. So let's keep that up and show our support for those women who are keeping their children and for the little children who are born. Thank you again and good morning.
We'll have the lighting of the Advent candles by two new members, Michelle Bushy and John Mack.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The love of God for us and for the whole world is the reason for this season of Advent. Jesus summarized our entire obligation to God with two commandments: love God and love your neighbor as you love yourself. True love is much more than a feeling. It's the way we treat God and each other. This Christmas, let's give the gift of love to everyone we meet. Let us pray. Eternal God, we adore you. Thank you for the gift of love we find in Jesus. Help us to pass that gift on to others, especially to those who do not yet know you as their Savior. This we lift up to you in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. Please stand with us to worship the Lord.
Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord, hear my voice. For with the Lord is unfailing love and full redemption. Our hymn this morning will be O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, number 123.
Come, 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 come
Please be seated. So Russell is in the Air National Guard. He's headed back to drill. Aren't we grateful for folks who are out there to be ready to protect us and protect our freedoms? Amen. Thank you, Russell. Let's bow our heads and pray. Master, the words that we've just sung are words that ring true. We do want you to bid envy, strife, and quarrels to cease. And we confess that envy, strife, and quarrel is a pretty good definition of the sin in our lives, and the sin in the lives of others, and just of the world in general. God, forgive us when we're envious. We find ourselves being envious of other people, perhaps them, and perhaps what they have that we think we don't have. Forgive us and fill that envy instead with contentment of all the gifts you've given us. And we confess to being people who tend to cause strife. Please, God, forgive us when we do that. And in place of that strife, would you give us peace in our interactions with others, people we know and people that perhaps we don't know, especially close to home in our families. Take away the strife and replace it with peace. And God, we confess to being a part of many quarrels, maybe through text or email or on Facebook or other social media or in person. We're just argumentative so much of the time. It seems it's been ramped up this year as there are so many issues that we're divided on. And God, would you please help us to substitute quarrels for something very much better, very deeper, much more wonderful. Instead of quarrels, understanding, agreeability, even when we disagree. And God, may that kind of ending of strife and envy and quarrels be multiplied from our lives and out into the world in which we live. We ask particularly that there would be an end to those three key sins in the nation's life, in our schools, in our churches, in the lives of governments all over this planet. Thank you, God, for those who are on the front lines, those who wear the uniform of our nation's military, firefighters, paramedics, police officers, sheriff's deputies, all those in law enforcement, nurses and doctors, teachers, pharmacists, researchers, all those who are doing so much to stand watch for us. And God, we ask for a return to a time when we had civility in the country, when only a small minority would be opposed to law and order and health and peace. Help us to be a part of the solution. May our faith be contagious. We seem to be so frightened of a virus that 99.4% of the people don't die from. And we ask that you would be with those who are sick and are suffering and are so afraid, that you would give them peace and confidence and hope, but that something that really can be very contagious and without it can lead to death, and that's joy, that we would have that, and it would be contagious from our lips, from our handshakes, our hugs, our hearts, our concern for others, because without it, people who are alone and afraid will die. And we ask that we would be a part of helping others know that we can live with Jesus and then die with him and live with him forever. May we be a part of sharing that good news. And God, we thank you for the one who came, sent for us and for all those who name him as Savior. The one who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." You glad to have the choir back? Amen. Would you stand, please, and let's say what we believe using ancient words, the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the one holy and universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated. I think we got some other kids coming, so we'll wait just a minute for them, but I'll give you kind of a heads up on what we're going to do. We're going to play I Spy. You know how to play I Spy?
Yes.
Okay. You like it? I thought you probably would. So I'm going to start out, and when other kids come in, we'll let them each have a turn. Everybody will get a turn. So I'm going to start out, I spy with my little eye something golden, and see if you can guess. All right, where do you guess, baby? Come on in here, y'all. Morning. Good morning. Come on in here. We're playing I Spy. You know how to play that? So it's fun, isn't it? All right, well, I'm starting out, and I said that I spy with my little eye something golden. Okay, that's a good guess, but that's not it. How did you guess it was the crown that quick? All right, it's the crown. So look up here at the crown. So it's at the top of our Christmas tree. And at your house, you might have, like we have at our house, we have a star at the top of our tree. And some people have an angel. Well, why do you think we put a crown up there? Good. Yeah, he's always first. He's the king, right? He's the king of kings. All right, now let's let somebody else go. Let's let a girl go first to do I Spy. All right, baby. All right, Bradley says she spies with her little eye something brown. Who wants to guess? What do you guess?
It's the manger.
Is it the manger? No? She kind of looked that way, didn't she? I thought that's what it was, too. All right, it's not the manger. Uh-oh, is she good?
Yeah.
All right, somebody guess else, something brown. All right, baby. Chloe, what do you think it is? Is it the Advent candle stand? Nope, it's not that. What do you think it is, buddy? You know your sister. What do you think she picked?
Is it the railing?
No. Can you give us a hint?
Is it one of the ornaments?
All right, we need a hint. It's over here. Is it the hay? No. Is it this part of the ornament? No. All right, somebody else guess. Are you going to show us, baby? All right, come on. Yeah, it's the manger. Yeah, Levi guessed it. Okay, so it was the manger. That was a good one. A crib, okay. Yeah, okay. All right, Levi, you go. What do you pick? Green. Who wants to guess? All right, Gabe, what do you think?
Wreath.
Is it the wreaths?
No.
Not the wreaths.
Is it
that arrangement? He says no. All right, babe, what do you think it is? Is it the Christmas tree?
Yeah,
all right. Good deal. All right, who wants to go next? All right, Gabe.
Something white.
What do you think it is, Bradley?
White. Is
it the, like the part of wood right there? No, not that. What do you think it is, baby?
I think it might be one of the
ornaments. Is it one of the ornaments? Nope. All right, what do you think it is, Lana? Is it the blanket around baby Jesus?
No.
Yes, that is. That's right. All right, give us a hint. It's up here on the chancel. What do you think it might be? Look up here on the chancel, right? What do you think it is, baby? Is it the snow in the picture? Isn't that a good-looking picture? I love that. Not the candles. What about the pulpit? Is it the pulpit? No? All right, somebody else guess. The The baptismal font, maybe? All right. Is that it? All right, Gabe, we need a hint. Okay. Okay, the stripe on the American flag. That was a good one. Okay. Now, because of time, we're going to stop because of time. But listen, isn't it fun to play I Spy, and especially in here when everything's decorated for Christmas? We had a service in here yesterday, and there were some people that had never been to our church, and they were kind of like this. They couldn't believe how beautiful it is. We kind of take it for granted. And the ladies and gentlemen that get together and decorate the church for Christmas, it's really beautiful. So y'all, when you want Christmas pictures made, this is the place to do it. So beautiful, where we worship our God. All right, put your hands together. Close your eyes. And we'll say, Father, I love you. Thank you for loving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank y'all. Bye, sweetie. Giving.
Continue as they have been.
Would you pray with me, please? Oh God, during this time of year when we think about the angels singing to the shepherds, take us in our mind's eye back to that wonderful night when Jesus was born. And as we've just sung about angels again, the heavenly host praising you in heaven, give us a glimpse of that as much as is possible for us to sense what it must be like to be in heaven, to sing your praises. And would that same kind of joy please inhabit our praise, God? Would you make that possible? May we continue to praise you in this sanctuary. May the internet continue to be used in powerful, good ways that our services would be broadcast. And we ask, God, that the end result would be that more and more people praise you publicly with song, with giving, with their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. I'm going to do something a little different this morning. I almost always read the Old Testament lesson first, but I'm going to read the New Testament lesson first because it's about Jesus' being born as God's plan before the universe was even created. That's what Paul is going to talk about here in Ephesians 1. So my series for Advent and Christmas is about Jesus himself. The plan, the period, the place, the person, and then the purpose. Today let's look at the plan, God's eternal plan to send Jesus Christ. So find Ephesians, either look at it on the screen or find it in your Bible, Pew Bible, or find it on your phone. You learn it better, you retain it better if you look at it and you hear it. So please have it in front of you in some way. Paul writes, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him when, listen, before the creation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us." You know, that's not just a Presbyterian word. That's a biblical word. "He predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace, that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ." Now let's go to the Old Testament lesson. We've seen how God planned for Jesus to come before the creation of the world. And now let's see how Jesus and his birth even figures into the Garden of Eden. Very fascinating. The story is that Adam and Eve did what we've done ever since. They decided they would make the rules. "Why should God make the rules?" they said. "We'll make our own rules." And the devil tempted them to do just that. He comes into the Garden of Eden in the form of a serpent. There's usually, generally, a universal fear of snakes, right? So think about the theology there. He does what he does best. He deceives them. They bite into it, literally and figuratively, and they're going to be punished. But the first one who's punished is the devil. And God lets the devil know that he's not going to win. Verse 14 of chapter 3. "So the Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." And we're going to look at how that verse 15 is a prophecy of the coming of Jesus. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? Thank you, God, for this time together that we call a sermon. Thank you for giving us your plan in the words of the Bible, for helping us to see fairly clearly as much as is possible for us to understand in our humanity, that your will, your plan, has always been to save us through Christ. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, what's taken you by surprise lately? If we think about this year, a whole lot of things have taken us by surprise, right? Suddenly there was this virus that came from China and the whole world has been troubled by it. Some folks have gotten sick. Some people have died. Most people, at least in the beginning, were scared to death. And then this election, it's still not over. It surprised us. What's going to happen with it? The unrest in the country, I never, ever thought I would see people burning down cities like we've seen, looting and rioting. It surprised us. But it didn't surprise God. God doesn't react. God knows his plan. It's different for us. Even when we try to plan ahead, more often than not, the old adage rings true. My grandmother used to say it all the time. The best laid plans of mice and men, right, often go awry. It's not that way with God. If he plans something, it's going to happen. Things always go according to his plan, and God is never surprised. He never has to regroup and come up with a different scheme. He never says the kind of things that we say, "Well, I planned on that, but it didn't happen that way, so I guess I'll have to regroup." That doesn't happen with God. Let me tell you something. That's one of the most comforting things about our faith. God has us in the palm of his nail-pierced hand. God is taking care of us. He's taking care of the universe. And the things that he allows to happen that are bad are things he allows to happen to draw us closer to him. God's plan has always been salvation. That means then that before the creation of the world, there was Christmas, so to speak. The birth of Jesus was planned by God before he even made the universe. In a nutshell, God's plan has always been redemption. Before the creation of the universe, he planned for Jesus to be born. Isn't that fascinating? Isn't that a joy to think about? That's what Paul means in Ephesians 1. Paul's famous for these long sentences, kind of run-on sentences, and he throws in all kinds of theology. Listen to what he says. God chose us in Jesus Christ before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and his will. So many people think of God's will as something foreboding. And God is this big being in heaven and he's looking down on us, ready to punish. Well, God does let us feel the consequences of our sins. There's no doubt about that. But his goal is salvation. He loves us. He longs for us to love him in return. Paul continues, "In him, Jesus, we have redemption through his blood." That means the cross was also planned before the creation of the universe. "The forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of His grace that He lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. God is an abundant giver. God gives abundantly. He doesn't give miserly. And many of us think of God in kind of a Scrooge miserly-like way. God is not like that. God gives in abundance. God gives lovingly, knowingly. We see it in His creation, do we not? We live in a part of the world in which we have a change of seasons. So we see the beautiful branch structure in the trees right now. A few weeks ago, we saw the leaves as they change colors. We're going to have a little snow in Memphis, hopefully. One thing we like about snow in Memphis is that it comes and goes pretty quickly, but it's beautiful. Think about it as it comes down. Think how peaceful it is. God lavishly gives us His creation. What about God's Word? It's an abundant gift. God didn't just give us a little pamphlet. He gives us this big, wonderful book that tells us about Jesus, about creation, about His interactions with people all through biblical times. God has given us lavishly what He's revealed to us in the Bible. And we see it most in Jesus Christ. God gives abundantly. Jesus lived the life that we live. He was fully human and He was also fully divine. So He interprets for us what life is really like, what really matters. And God took upon Himself in Jesus our sins. He took death so that we would not experience death in a horrible way. So that when we love Him, death for us is merely an entrance into God's heaven. God is an abundant giver. The Westminster Confession of Faith talks about this in a really beautiful way. The distance between God and His creation is so great that although reasoning creatures owe Him obedience as their creator, they nonetheless could never realize any blessedness or reward from Him without His willingly condescending to them, without God coming down to us. God sits high, but He comes low, down to us. That means then that our limitations, our imperfections, are a window to God. And I want you to stop a minute and I want you to think about that. That is not generally the way we look at our sins. Our limitations, our imperfections are a window to God because we're only able to respond to the Lord's grace because He confronts us with two facts. One, we're sinners, and two, God saves sinners. Without the sin, we would not experience the love and the mercy of God. Among all the world's religions, past, present, and I should have said future in my notes, Christianity alone teaches that instead of man searching and grasping for God, God found man. Every other religion, I don't care what it is, every other religion is looking for God. Well, maybe I can find God over here. Maybe if I look at this, maybe if I meditate enough, maybe if I'm good enough, on and on and on it goes. Christianity alone says, you ain't good enough. You'll never be good enough. God is the good one, and He came down in the form of a baby who grew to die on a cross and be raised again. He's revealed Himself to us. The differences between all the other religions and all those cults, all those thinking and ways of looking at life, all of those in Christianity can be summarized in one word: Jesus. Who is Jesus? If you read my newsletter article, I talked about this. It's funny to me, I think about our pastor emeritus, James Quillen, and he used to hold up a bulletin or a newsletter and say, do you even read this? It's like we don't know what's going to happen next week. We don't know what's going on. Well, what are we supposed to do today? We put it out there. You know, there's lots of ways for you to look at it, online, hard copy, whatever. But in the newsletter article, I talked about something that commonly happens to me as a Navy chaplain. I'll have a sailor or a marine say, "You know, chaps, I believe in God," kind of generically. "I believe in God, but I don't know. Which God is it? The God of the Muslims, the gods of the Hindus, the ancient Greek gods? Which one is it?" Well, God has told us very clearly, if we want to know what God is like, we look at Jesus. He came down to us. He lived a life like we live, with all the pain, all the sorrow, all the joy, and He died for us. If you want to know what God is like, you look at Jesus Christ. He's the only one of the teachers of religion throughout all of history who died and then came back. He's alive, and He loves us. Don't make it harder than it needs to be. God knows we're fairly simple-minded, and so He gave us a simple, loving way to know who He is. Presbyterian pastor Ben Lacey Rose said that people believe in either the monkey or the cat doctrine of salvation. And I've been teaching this ever since I went to seminary and first heard it, so maybe you've heard me talk about it. I use it fairly often because I think you need to know it and share it with other people. We either believe in the monkey doctrine, or the cat doctrine. Meow. Here's what it means. How does a mama monkey move her monkeys from one tree to the other? They better just hold on for dear life, because that's the way she moves them. She doesn't do it herself. They hold on, and as she's swinging through the trees, if one of them drops and goes down like Wile E. Coyote, so be it. If they want to hold on, if they want to live, they hold on to mama. And a lot of people look at religion like that. If I'm just good enough, if I can just do this, if I just won't do this, I've got to hold on to God. I think I found him or her. I think I have. And they just hold on for dear life. Well, guess what? Your arms are going to get tired, and your heart's going to give out. That's not the God of the Bible. That's not the one true living God. He's not like the mama cat. Excuse me, the mama monkey. He's like the mama cat. When the mama cat wants to move her kittens from this basket over to this basket or from this hiding place to this hiding place, what does she do? She reaches down and she chooses the one to go first and second and third and fourth and fifth, and she carries them in her mouth to that place. God is like that in salvation. I hope it's not sacrilegious, because Dr. Rose and then me, I've used this illustration forever and ever. God is like the mama cat. He's holding on to you. He's holding on to me. You don't have to worry about holding on to him. He's got you. And he's going to move you from this life to heaven, and in this life from all the other places. God has you safely in his grasp. Which doctrine of salvation do you believe in? Do you believe in what the Bible teaches, that God is like the mother cat and he has you safely? Or do you believe in the monkey doctrine, where you just got to hold on and it's a pretty scary ride? I think I'm going to choose to believe in what the Bible teaches. How about you? That means then that we don't only have Christmas before the creation of the universe, we fast forward to having Christmas in Genesis. And that's what we see in the third chapter of Genesis. The devil, old Scratch, thought he had Adam and Eve and all of us truly convinced that we'd turn away from God. And God said, "Uh-uh. That ain't my plan." Nobody thwarts God's plan. And so the Lord God told the devil, "The woman's offspring will crush the serpent's head, and you, serpent, will strike him with your heel," his heel, rather. And that is to say, Mary's son, the offspring, Mary's son, will crush the devil's head, and the devil will attempt to kill Jesus. He did try. It's called the proto-evangelion by theologians. Here early in the beginning of the Bible, in the beginning of the myths of early history, we have God telling us the devil is not going to win. I'm going to send Jesus. Had God not allowed Adam and Eve to sin, we would not know about His grace. And I want you to chew on that a little bit today. It's a different way of looking at our lives. If we were not sinners, if we had not messed up, we wouldn't really understand the great love and mercy of God. The birth of Jesus was the beginning of the fulfillment of the prophecy in Genesis of the devil's demise. Old Scratch is not going to win the day. We know the rest of the story as Christians. God wins, and we're on His team. Which fast forwards us then to Christmas 2020. The plan hasn't changed. It's the same plan. God saves us through Jesus Christ. It was always God's intention to send Jesus to be our Savior, because He knew salvation would be our greatest need. Now, we don't really look at it often that way. Our greatest need, we think, is the next job, the next house, the next boyfriend, the next girlfriend, the next test to take, the next basket to make, whatever it is, the next vacation to go on, the next game to play. That's what we see as our greatest need. But it's not. Our greatest need is salvation. That's what Christmas is about. That's why we have communion today as we celebrate the coming of Jesus into the world. It's about our salvation. So, y'all, that means that the horror of the cross and the joy of the empty tomb were already in play at the manger. As Jesus was being rocked by Mary and laid gently in that manger, the cross loomed over it. But so did the empty tomb, that Jesus would never die again, so you and I could live forever. Don't you need to hear that good news this Christmas? There's a lot of bad news out there. Don't you need to hear some good news? I certainly do. Who do you need to share that good news with this Christmas? Who in your family? Who among your friends, neighbors, people you work with? Who do you need to share that good news with? Or I guess maybe the real question is, you know who you need to share it with. The real question is, will you do it? Don't keep such good news to yourself. Amen? Let's pray together. Lord our God, thank You for being a giving God, a God who gives lavishly, abundantly. Thank You for being the God who intended salvation for His people long before the universe was made. And then as Eden and Adam and Eve and the devil began what we know as history, thank You, God, for being the God who saves. May we understand as much as we can Your intention has always been salvation and redemption. In the name of Jesus, amen. Would the elders serving the Lord's Supper please come to the table? Now, y'all, I have missed seeing this window. I love our technology, but I want to see this window sometimes. And some of you have told me that you want to see it also. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to try this. And I know this is a little noisy, but so what? We're going to have the window come up during the Lord's, the screen come up during the Lord's Supper so that we can see some of our history from our old church, and we can remember the Good Shepherd, those who brought this church out here and made sure that this window was reinstalled. There's going to be a little bit of noise when I go back up after the Lord's Supper before we sing the next hymn. The screen's going to come back down. But will you please just live with a little noise? It's okay. We have wonderful technology. But we have a beautiful old window too. And I want us to enjoy both. We're coming to the Lord's table this morning during the Christmas season. We're going to be thinking about the body and the blood of Jesus shed for us, broken for us. When we're also thinking about the baby Jesus, because that's the story. The story is of a God who entered our story. History is His story. He came because all along He's loved us. He chose you. He chose me before He even made the world. What a treasure that is to know that. We're going to do what we've been doing the past several months with the Lord's Supper. Remember that the bread is also in a little juice cup, just like the juice is. You're going to come up by pews. You will get this little cup with bread. You'll get a little cup with juice. And then if you would, take that back to the pew and reflect a little bit on the majesty, the mystery of your salvation. And then we'll take those elements together. Let's bow our heads. God, I thank You for everyone who's come to church today. For everyone who knows that You love them. And I pray for those who don't yet know it. Or perhaps those for whom it's first beginning to seem like a reality. And I ask that the celebration of the Lord's Supper will help to cinch it for them. They'll begin to understand as much as humans can that the God of the universe gave His life because He wanted them to live with Him forever. And so would You please sanctify these elements, this bread, this juice, to that spiritual use to which You have ordained them, that we, Your people, would be nourished, and our thirst for grace would be quenched. In the name of Jesus, amen. The Bible tells us that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, He took bread. It would have been flat, unleavened bread, kind of like this. The Bible says that He took that bread, and after having given thanks, as has been done in His name, He broke that bread. As I, ministering in His name, break this bread and give it to you. And He told them in the upper room, "This is My body. It's given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me. Eat this in remembering Me." And after the same manner, the Bible says our Savior also took a cup. It would have been a chalice, probably not this fancy, not this beautiful. But it would have been a cup that looked similar to this. And He said, "This cup is the New Testament in My blood, shed for you, for the remission of your sins. Drink, all ye of it. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes again." Would you come to the Lord's table? even in the Garden of Eden, God knew he was going to send Jesus to be your Savior. Would you join me in taste and see that the Lord is good? And together let's acknowledge that the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for us. Pray together. God, would you help us to be both humbled and overwhelmed at the mystery and the joy and the lavish love revealed to us in the birth and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, for this time together. May we sense that we're loved. May we feel nourished. May we feel our thirst for grace quenched. So much so that we share that grace and that love of Jesus with others. We ask it and thank you for the plan that made it possible. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together and join in singing 127, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne.
Thank you.
Elders, please remember there's a called meeting to receive a new member this morning. Now, how is this person going to come into full fellowship of the church? By saying that she loves Jesus Christ. She wants to be a part of this fellowship. But the only requirement is that she loves Jesus. Maybe that's where you are, but you haven't yet committed yourself to this congregation. Well, I'd like to talk to you about that and encourage you to be a part of a people in a place where we love Jesus Christ and want others to love Him too. Now may God's grace, mercy, and peace be yours. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.